This is my NISA My Life orientation session. It will be held online for you guys. That's wherever you are, at home, at work. And we also have students in the venue itself. My name is Johan de Beer. I'm one of the DLAs at the Florida campus. And we deal specifically with all your problems regarding my NISA My Life and any queries that you have regarding your online part of your NISA studies. Today's session will be to show you guys how to use my NISA in my life, how to get your modules, how to do your assignments, how to do the forums and things like that, and explain just in short how everything will work for this online environment at UNISA. I'm just going to start the session quickly with a few things for guys that's having problems with authenticating and things like that. So most students, as soon as they start, they might get this screen, right? If you get this screen when trying to log on to your My NISA or My Life account for the first time, this is fine. You will be able to sort this out. This is just a screen that you have to follow to complete all of your setups. I'll be posting a file in the chat for everybody to use with easy steps to follow how to finish the setup and how to be able to log into your account. Then students that's getting this part, that already tried to do the setup and is facing this problem of the authenticating app. Usually when you get this screen, it means that your phone number has not been linked to your Microsoft account. So if you get this screen, we need to add your Microsoft or your cell phone number to your Microsoft account so that your cell phone can be used as an OTP system for you to log in. This has been brought in as an extra safety measure so that when you log on to new devices, it will require you to verify that it's you via your cell phone. All right, so if you have this problem as well, at the end, I'll explain to you what to do so that we can fix this for you as well. The next problem students have, if they log in as well, they get to this screen and the numbers will be showing there will not be their numbers. If any of you ever get this problem that is showing a cell phone number there not being your number or old number that you don't have anymore, you'll have to inform us as well so that we can update your number on the Microsoft side of the system. If you change your number on my NISA, it will not resolve this problem. So don't think if you change your number on my NISA, it will change on Microsoft. It's two separate systems, right? So if you have any of these problems, what you're going to have to do is, here's the instructions. You can email us, all right? There's two DLAs in Florida, myself, Johan, and then my colleague, Masabata. Our emails is there on the screen as well. I will post this presentation in the chat as well, so that you can have all of our contact details there. And I'll also put in our emails in the chat itself. So if you have any of these problems, you're going to have to email us. You can email us then from your Gmail or whatever it is, because we know you can't access My Life. If that's the case, you email us from your Gmail, Workmail, wherever it is. In the subject, please include your student number and state Microsoft login problem so that we know what the email will be about. Also in the email itself, please use your number that we must put on the system, all right? And so that we can update your numbers to the correct numbers. If you supply us with the wrong number, we'll not be able to help you and you're going to have the wrong numbers again. All right. If you're going to email us, please only email one of the DLAs. Do not email both me or Masabata. Right. You have to email just one of us. Otherwise, you get the same query that I do, then it clogs up the system when we want to update your details. All right. So as I said, I'll be posting all of this in the chat for the guys that's online as well. And it will be available for everybody afterwards as well. For the guys that's in the venue itself, we'll try and assist you after the session if you have any of these problems to assist you in person as well. For the guys online, this will be the procedure you're going to have to follow to get your authentication method sorted. I'm going to hand over now to my colleague Masabata, and she'll be going through the My NISA and showing you step by step where everything is and how it works. Thank you very much, guys.
My name is Masabata Matsetse. I am the digital learning advisor together with my colleagues here. So the purpose of today's workshop, as they already explained to you guys, is to make sure you know how to use My NISA effectively. Some of you, yes, might have already logged in and checked this and that, but we just want to verify that you know where your assignments are, how to submit them, and all those things. So as you are already aware, we have audience here and some are online. Questions will only be taken at the end of the session. So we won't be answering any questions during the presentation. We will have time for questions. Everyone will need to be on the UNISA website for the sake of this training. Are we able to go to the UNISA website? Yes, you can Google UNISA or can type www.unisa.ac.za. Let me start it with you guys. You can watch on the screen. Are we able to go to Google? Yes. No, you've never Googled anything. It's no different. It's the same thing. All right. You either open Google Chrome or Microsoft Edge on the computer that you are using. I'm currently on Google Chrome. And in there, you're going to type UNISA. Then you press enter. Then this is what you will get. Then you go UNISA online. You click on UNISA online. Once it opens, you go to My UNISA. It's at the top right corner. Can you see it? You click on My UNISA, then you're going to land on this page. So today we're going to be working on logging to My Modules and My Admin together with My Life email address. We're not going to be doing logging to SBL. Are we all in the same page? Because right now we're going to log into My Modules. I would love for everyone, if they have a computer in front of them, to do the same thing. Click on log into My Modules. I'm just going to assume everyone has already claimed their My UNISA account details, meaning the login, which is your password. It's not given to you automatically after you register. You need to claim that password and it will be sent to you via an SMS. So to the audience online, if you don't have access, please claim the password so that you can join us in the practical session. And the next step is now clicking on this. So you sign in with your student My Life email address. Do we all know our email addresses? Not the private ones, but My Life email address. It's given to you when you request this login details on My UNISA. So everyone that is not in, now we're going to go to the stage where we're going to enter our email addresses with the same format that I projected. There is your My Life email address. Every time you go to My Modules, you're going to have to use this email address. So it's very important that you know it by heart. Did you all get it? Can I move to the next step? Please check it. I'll leave it for one more minute so that everyone can check the format. It starts with your student number at My Life. .unisa.ac.za. It's important that you write it down if you do not know it by heart, because you're going to need it every time. I'll just give it a few more seconds. Oh, another important factor. If you did not have My UNISA login details and you just claimed the account today, just note that My UNISA takes about 48 hours to work. So you're not going to have full access to everything. I'm going to repeat that. If you just claimed your password now, you're not going to be able to log into My UNISA and My Life. If you happen to be able to log into MyUNISA, perhaps your subject will not be loaded, so you'll have limited access. Can I move from this part? Next part is where you need to enter the MyUNISA password, the one that was SMS'd to you when you first claimed your account. Please put in your login details there, which is your password, and sign in. Also note the password is case sensitive. So where you see a small letter, enter a small letter. If you see a number, it has to be a number. If you see a capital letter, it has to be a capital letter. I'm also going to put mine. So on this step, some of you might be blocked by what we call authenticator app. If you are not able to get to this step after entering your password, that means you either have authenticator problems or other problems. That's where my colleagues mentioned, email us your details so that we sort it out for you. But unfortunately, it won't be now. We'll have to attend to that at the end of the session or tomorrow. So those who manage to log in, the next step, if you are not logging on your computer like you guys here, it's important on this step you say no. But then if you are accessing this from your own cell phone or laptop, then you can say yes, so that the computer will remember your password. Are we all inside MyUNISA? Can you see my modules? Can you see my admin? Okay. So we are inside my modules. That means we will only work with my modules. If you can recall, before we click on my modules, there was also login to my admin. So if you go to my admin, you need to access it outside of my modules. The same way when you click on login to my admin, there will be my modules, but that my modules will not work. So if you want to go to my modules, click on my modules from MyUNISA before you get here. Same as my admin, because this admin here, it's not fully functional. I hope that makes sense. So while we are here, first step is gonna be my modules. You need to click on that drop down. And everything that is reflecting there, it has to be the subjects that you chose when you registered. Are you familiar with those subjects that you're seeing there? Because if you're seeing anything different, then something is wrong with your account. You will need to bring it to our attention so that we sort it out for you. So if you are doing 10 subjects or 5, you will see all of them displaying there. All the subjects that are ending with S1, it means you are registered for those subjects in the first semester. And if you happen to have registered for second semester already, you will have subjects that are ending with S2. That's correct. And if you have subjects that are ending with a Y, it's year modules too. All right, so we're going to, for the sake of this exercise, we're going to pick just one subject out of those and go through everything. Like, where is the assignment? Where is the study material for this? And all those things. But what you will need to do is to now go and change on all the subjects on your own, because obviously now we can open all 10 subjects and do everything. So what you're going to learn on this exercise, you will need to make sure you're using all the other exercises. And also note that subjects are not structured the same. There will be some subject where some information is located in different, but we'll go through all those as we go ahead. So you can choose anything But if you have EUP 1501, I want you to listen to this. If you have EUP, don't select it now. If you have SJD, do not select it now. If you have SUS, do not select it. If you have, what is the other ones, Johan? BBT 1501, those are different types of subjects. And if you select any of those, they are structured completely different from this. We might have a special training for only those subjects. I cannot now do a practical session for those because not everyone is doing that. Does that make sense? So please select any other subject except those that I've mentioned. I'm gonna go with this one. So any subject from your region. Remember, we are doing now different courses. Yes, some are doing law, teaching, and all these other qualifications. So everything is not gonna be exactly the same, but the structure, it's almost the same. Are we together? What do you see on your screen? Is it the same thing that we see here? No. What do you see if it's not this? Try to switch to a different subject. And also, let's not forget to assist our neighbors. Just check on your neighbor if they moved from the last step we were in. Are we still fine? All right, so I'm going to start here. FAQs, we all know that is frequently asked questions. We're going to skip that. It's not really that important to us for the sake of your training. Do we all have prescribed material? Do you all see that on your chosen subjects? Please click on it and see what is it that you are having. If there is a book loaded in there, like a title, author, yeah, and all those options, please know that you need to go and purchase this book. It's very important. That means the contents of your assignment and your exam will be based in this book. And this book is not part of your official study material that UNISA will be sending to you. You need to go and buy it. Did you get that? And also, if there is no book there, doesn't mean you are off the hook. There's another place where some lectures can put that information for the book that you are required to purchase. We'll go check that as we go along. We have, again, the option that says official study material. Do you all have that? Click on that. Let's see what your lectures has loaded for you under that option. For this particular student, I see tutorial letter 301 and tutorial letter 101. Do you have anything loaded in your study material? Yes, that is very important. You need to download those and check what is that. Some of you who chose to be given study material online and in hard copies, such tutorial letters will be couriered to you. Or if you have chosen the option to collect the study material on campus, we do have that option. Then you will be notified via an SMS to come and get your study material. But then we have also another option where students just say online only. So if you chose online only, just know nothing will be sent to you via courier, or you won't be notified to come and collect any study material. So if you did that by a mistake, next semester before you pay, when you register, rectify that so that you have an option to go and select manual hard copies to be sent to you or to be collected on campus. So remember, I said there is another place if where you can be told of a certain book to buy. So I'm going to now show you. You don't really need to open this. You can just look at me on the screen. If you have tutorial letter 101 listed there, you will need to open and download everything there. So now I just want to show you on this tutorial letter where the other information will be. So tutorial letter 101, it's very important. That's where they give you introduction about the particular qualification, the subject. So if you are doing five subjects, you will have five tutorial letter 101s for each subject. So for example, if you want to know who is your lecturer, can you see we have lecturer and contact details there. So if you want to know who's your lecturer for a certain subject, you can just quickly come here and check there. We have Dr. Who and who, the email address and the contact details. Also, we have the department contact details. And just underneath that, can you see we have prescribed books? And for this student, they said none. What do you have on yours? Is there anyone who's required to buy a book for that subject that they currently open? Well, remember, you need to go and check for all your subjects. We're just showing you how to check it, but you're going to have to now take that knowledge to all the other subjects that you are doing. Just underneath that, can you see they also have recommended books? That is very important as well. But this is not a must. If you have a prescribed, it's a must that you purchase it. But then if you have a recommended book, that is if you need additional information. It's not a must to buy it. But if you have extra cash or you know how to download books online and all those things, then you can get this one as well. It's just for additional information, but it's not a must. Meaning somehow you can still pass the subject without this. Does that make sense? Yes. So like I say, tutorial letter 101 is very important. Go through it. There is a whole lot of other information that is relevant to you as a student. There is also study plans, but we're not going to be talking about these ones because we had orientations the whole of last week. And some of the colleges and departments at UNISA, they were talking about study plans, time management, and everything else that you need. For now, my role is to just let you know that you have 101, it's important, go through it. And you'll have 10 if you're doing 10 subjects. So I'm gonna pass this one. Some lectures will have loaded here a study guide. But then, like I say, each subject is gonna be different. I can quickly switch to another one so that you are able to see. Let me see this one. Maybe we might have a study guide for this one. I'm just gonna check. Well, still the same info. So that's how you're going to check for all your other subjects as well, what you've been provided with. So far, I don't see much for this particular student, but as we go along, we'll just keep. Yes, can you see this is different? I've quickly just changed from my modules and selected a different subject. Can you see for this module, there is now a study guide. It's loaded twice, same size, so I believe it's same thing. You don't need to download or print both. But imagine if you chose online only. That means now you have to download this, save it on your computer. Yes, I was still making an example. I'm sorry for those that are online. We just had a technical challenge, but we are back online. I was still explaining this. If you happen to have chosen the online only, that means such a study guide will not be sent to you. If you want a hard copy of it, you have to print it yourself. Is it not a waste? Exactly, because it's probably, I'm not going to open it, but it's probably a very big study guide. So next time, just please choose for courier and collection of your books. Online will always be there for everyone. But if you happen to have this, now you're going to have to download it and always read it. Look at it. It's 166 pages. So if you chose online only, that means you're only going to read this on your computer or on your phone. But then we know some laptops, they need to be plugged in on the power source for them to work. So imagine if you have an old laptop like that one and you have load shedding for so many days. How are you going to read and prepare for exams? So just to be safe, make sure you select courier and also the collection on campus. Are we fine? All right. So I'm going to go back so that we use all other. Another important is this one. Can you see welcome message on all of us? Can you see that? Each subject needs to have a welcome message. A welcome message is actually from your lecture. That's where they tell you who they are. I'll just open the one I have for this particular student. Can you see, dear student, welcome to, that is from your lecture. It's important that you go through that and understand. Can you see, you will also find your study guide for this module on the official study material. So in case you didn't open what official study material yet, and here is your lecture introducing themselves to you and telling you about a study guide that is under our official study guide, then you will look where is official study material and go get your study guide. So you should have all this, but like I said, things will be different for each and every subject. If you can remember, even in high school, even in primary, we had teachers who just wanted to come in class and mind their own business instead of teaching. So same thing still happen even at university. You'll find some lectures who don't go all out for the student, but certain lectures will go all out and even give you extra information. So keep that in mind, that on some modules you might be given only what you need. But then on the other subject, then you have this lecture who will even tell you about the scope of your exam. That's just the point I'm trying to put through, guys, so that you know that you can't come back here and say, this lecture has given me previous question papers for the past 2 years. And now I have this other module, there's no previous question papers. It's not a must. Those who go extra mile, it's because of the goodness of their heart. And if you need anything content related to that particular subject, you need to contact that lecture. Does that make sense? Yes. All right, now we're going to move. So it's important that you read all those welcome messages. I'm not going to read them for you, but can you see for this particular student, the lecture is TP Mutala. And there is the contact details, and also there is the email address. And as you go further down, we have some folders. Can you see folders on your laptops, computers, or on your phone? They will also be different depending on the subjects that you are doing. Can we start with the forum? Do we all have the forum? If you don't have a forum on that particular subject, quickly just change modules and go to a different subject so that you see how forums looks like. You will come into contact with it at some point, so it's important that you know what that is for. So if you have forums, quickly let's just go on it. This one, it's written forum, but then again, announcement. So announcements are very important, very important. Any changes of anything that is going to happen during the course of the semester, you will be notified in your announcement. let's say there is a change perhaps in closing date, or they realize that question two of assignment two was somehow incorrect, they will fix it in the announcement. But if you don't check your announcement, you're still gonna stick to the questions that were posted in January, but they later realize that there is a mistake and you didn't check your announcement. That is already a zero for that question for you. Do you understand the importance of that? So let's quickly just check if there's any announcements for that particular subject. For this one, there is nothing, but I'm quickly gonna change the subjects and see if I don't have any subjects that have active announcement. So you can do the same if you selected a subject that didn't have announcement. Can you see for this one, we have an announcement. Let's see. It's written here, assessment. But then again, remember I switched now the module. So I don't know who's the lecturer for this particular subject. The previous one we saw it was who and who Mutala, but here we don't know. So it's important for you as a student to know who is your lecturer, because at some point, other students will be given options to post announcement. Should I repeat that? As a student, you will be given access to post here, because that's how you're going to engage with your fellow student and the lecturer. And if you don't know who is who in this group, the important person that you need to know is only the lecturer. Others will be student. So you will need to check which messages were posted by the lecturer and always check those. So for this one, I'll just quickly go back to the the welcome message, just so that we verify who is who, so that we know who posted that, because it could be another student maybe just asking, when are the assignments opening? Things like those. Let me quickly see. This one is just say my UNISA team. I don't see the name of the lecture here. But remember, I told you, where else do you get the information about your lecture? Tutorial letter 101. Do you remember that? Yes. All right. For the sake of time, we're just going to assume this is the lecture. I believe it is the lecture. So you will check. Okay, another important, I don't know if we have a subject that is like that. Some discussion forum, they will have a message that says closed. Please open it even though it says closed. I don't know if it's an error or what. It is still functional even though it says closed. Because we have students that are coming here that I cannot participate in the discussion forums. But then when we open it, it's working. It's just that for some reason, it has a message that is closed. Should you find yourself with such, just click on the link. Once it's a link, you will see your hand is going, your mouse is going to change into a hand like that. Can you see that? Then you just open that. And here is the message from the lecture. For this one, they're saying, note that assessment one is on Moodle platform. Oh, how I wish they didn't say Moodle. And assignment two is included in tutorial letter 101. Can I repeat this statement? What this lecture is saying about this particular subject is questions to assessment one, which is assignment one, are on my UNISA here. But then assignment two, the questions are in tutorial letter 101. Meaning when you go to my UNISA to look for that assignment two, there might not be questions. You might need to go to that tutorial letter, which I said it has important information. There should be the questions there. So each module is going to be structured differently. So, but let's say you didn't read the announcement. and you've done your assignment one, and for some reason you are waiting for assignment two to be loaded on MyUNISA, but then they won't open it because they already opened it in, they already printed it. And those that have chosen the option to be sent the tutorial letters, then they'll receive it via post, courier, and whichever method UNISA will be using. But you see the importance of announcement. Exactly. So that is fine. Announcement, we are clear that are important. As a student, you will need to check them regularly. Let me go to another option. We have additional resources. Do you guys have additional resources in the chosen subject? If you have, click on it. If you don't have, change the subject and check the additional resources on that subject. On this particular student, I see the study guide and another PDF document there, transition tables. Do you have anything loaded on your study additional? Yes. So additional, the lecture will keep on loading stuff throughout the semester. So you might check it today, you find that there is one document or there is nothing, but later on there might be information loaded in there. So it's important that you keep checking additional resources. It's different from official. Official, it's gonna be like that until maybe if they mark the first assignment. I'm just not sure if UNISA is still issuing the feedback to your assignment in a form of tutorial letters, but if they are still issuing that, you will see there will be additional tutorial letters loaded in the official and also additional. But otherwise, I'll still show you where to locate your feedback to your assignment as you move along. So the point here, check additional resources for each and every subject. Can I move? And now we have assessment one. So assignment and assessment, it's same thing. Like some lectures will choose assignment and others will choose to use assessment. So just know assessment one, but they actually used the naming of assessment one. Just open it, it's still your the same thing. Are we fine with that one? Some lectures here will write assignment one and others assessment is the same thing. So for the sake of this assignment or assessment, do you all have assignment one or assessment one loaded on the particular subject that you've chosen? If we have, can we just verify that it's a quiz? Because the example that I'm going to do here is going to be a quiz. A quiz is a multiple choice. You will know it will be written here that it's a quiz. So what I'm saying is if the for that particular subject, the first assignment could be a written assignment. Just quickly change and go to a module that has any quiz. As long as it's loaded under assignments, even though it's assignment two or three, as long as it's a quiz so that you are able to go through with this exercise. Before you open that, I just want to share this with you as well. Can you see just underneath, they will tell you it opened on the 1st of January at 8. But that was a holiday, right? Yes. And it's closing on the 16th of April. Can you see that? So let's open it and see if it's open. So some lectures have the 1 January. They didn't edit it. But then for some reason, some they still didn't open the assignment. Meaning when you come here, your quiz is not open, but then can you check when it is due? Like April is still 2 months away. Yes, so some lectures will still go to the announcement and tell you this assignment will be opened on the 10th of April. That is now 6 days to the due date. Can you see that? Yes. So if you happen to have an assignment that is still not open, but in here it says opened on the 1st of January, you can ignore that and just keep checking your announcement. The right date will be posted in your announcement. As long as the due date is still far, then you are still safe. But let's say the assignment is due tomorrow and today is still not open, then you need to reach out to the lecturer for that particular subject. Are we fine on this one? Because I've seen quite a lot of lectures. They left 1 January, but then when you check the date, it's still very far. And here, they still didn't load the questions as well. Another important, please do not attempt any quiz. We have students who go through these quizzes, not thinking it's the actual assignments. They keep thinking the assignment is still coming and they just attempt and answer and get zeros and whatnot. I don't know, maybe we just need to change the way we have put this, but then I've seen quite a number of students who already submitted assignment one, especially if it's a quiz, but then without studying first. So let's not fall into that. And again, on this particular student, we are not told how many attempts. On yours, maybe you might have 2 attempts, 3 attempts. What does that mean? Do you know? Okay, those who don't know, that means you can submit that assignment 3 times. They will take the highest. But bear in mind, every time the questions are going to change. So you might actually get a 60 now on your first attempt, then get a 20 on your second attempt, get 0. But the highest one is the one that is going to be recorded. So I'm just going to project a different type of assignment. Hopefully I'll be lucky and get another quiz that has attempts for others to see. Just give me a sec. I just want to check if we have any quiz that has attempts so that everyone can actually see. Which one is this one? Yes, can you see the difference? This one, you are told attempts allowed, it's 2. So if no attempts are listed there, there is no 1, there is no 2, there is no 3, that means you get only 1 opportunity. So if it's more than 1, you are told. Don't look at your neighbor and say they have 3 attempts and assume you also have 3 attempts. You will be told for each and every assessment. And attempts are only valid if you are still within due date. You can submit your first attempt. Let me say, this one is due on the 17th at 9 o'clock. So you can submit this at 10 to 9 and get a 40 and say you are not satisfied. At 10 past 9, you're thinking you can still use the remaining attempt. Those attempts are valid only before this closes. And what happens when the closing date and the time comes? This attempt quiz, do you see this orange button here? It disappears on the system. Like it disappears. So Basically, there is no need to contact anyone. There is no need to be wasting your petrol or your taxi fare to come to UNISA to question it. Just move to the next one. As you can see, it's open already. You can actually do it. But we have students that are going to wait for the 17th at 9 o'clock and try to submit that. And imagine if all of you, your assignment are due at that time, you are on the same website, same module at that time. System, networks, load shedding, there could be many more reasons. So just know that if it's like this, you are welcome to do it any day before the due date. Don't wait for the final date. And once the button is not there, it's already a zero for you. And just move to assignment two. Can I move? All right. I'm not going to attempt to answer this because I don't want to fiddle with this assignment. So, but then once you click on attempt, you will get, if it's 20 questions, you'll get 20 questions. And we know once you were talking about multiple choice, it's a question with 4 or 5 possible answers, right? So you just click on the next one, next, until you finish with the last one. If it's 50, they will all be listed there. After the last one, then you'll have submit. After the last question, then you're gonna click on submit. And there is a message at the end that will tell you that your assignment has been successfully submitted. Make sure you get to that part where make a screenshot if you have to as a proof. I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to ask you all to now check a different type of assignment. It could be written, it could be, as long as it's not external forum, and all, because those are the 6 subjects that I mentioned in the beginning, because some of you still don't have access to those. So now quickly check if you have any assignments of out of the subjects that you've done. Like for this, for example, this student for this particular subject, it's only quizzes. So I can't do another example on a quiz. Let's locate any other assignments that is not a quiz. That's what I'm saying. So change the subject if you don't have that in that particular one. I'll just check here. A written assignment, it's those essay type, like discuss this, name this. That's the type of an assignment that I want us to go through now, if we have any. I think this could be it. I found one. I'm just going to give you 3 minutes to locate a subject in yours that has a written type of assignment. The other one is a quiz. You will know it. You will be able to see it. Just don't choose that one. Choose any, as long as it's not a quiz, so that we also go through an example on how you're going to submit that. I'm going to give you until 10 pass. Just to make sure you find the right type of assignment out of all your subjects. Seems like we all found it. If it's not there, it's fine. It is possible that some students will only have multiple choice assignments. And that should also tell you that your exam for that particular subject will also be a multiple choice. So here we have an example of a written assignment. Can you see the date opened as well? It says 1 January. And the closing date, it says on the 24th. So this student is quite lucky because they opened all the assignments way in advance. I know some lectures will only give you access like 2-3 days before, but then it's fine. Once you get to this place, it's important if there's some notes from your lecture before the questions that you go through those. For example, here, the following chapters in your Chemistry 2 textbook is critical for this assessment. Can you see, this is one of the lectures I told you about. Mm. Some will go extra mile. So basically here, the lecture is telling the student to focus on chapter one and chapter two of their prescribed book. Because that's where, there it is, chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, and 13. So, but not all lectures will do this. So just check if you have any notes before that, make sure you follow that. Some lectures will go as far as, even though it's not, but if you are not giving any, as long as whatever you are typing or you are writing, it's readable, I guess it's fine. And also remember, you're also welcome to use your handwritten. Yes, you can write. You don't always have to type. Yes, we want a PDF, but not everyone is a pro in typing. So you can still write, but your handwriting needs to be readable. Because once you type, you're still gonna have to scan that. And once you scan any document, somehow they change, the shape is changing. So just make it easier for whoever is going to mark your document that you don't get marked wrong because they can't read what you've written. Does that make sense? Yes. So if you can't type, write. All right, for this assignment, there is something highlighted in red. Please use your student number as the name of the document before you upload. Do you see that? That is from your lecture. So for this subject, it's chemistry. So meaning the final document that you're going to upload, it has to have the naming as your student number. Don't go writing assignment one, chemistry, your name, and all those things. They want only your student number. But if you are not told, you are going to choose anything, assignment one. So those are some of the instructions I was telling you about. Some lectures will be very strict. This table here, I'm still going to open that and show you. But then can you see the submission status? Since we're not going to be able to submit this, just know that after you submitted your assignment, come back to this table. Check submission status. Can you see it says no submissions have been made yet? Can you see that? After you submitted, it will show that your assessment has been, or whatever document has been submitted successfully. If I'm not mistaken, it will be written in green. So here it will say, obviously it does not mark immediately. It will update maybe to in process or something. And here it will also note the date and time you submitted. Are we still together? Yes. So for now, let's try. Maybe you can just watch. Don't open anything. Just look at what I'm gonna do. So the questions for this particular assignment, there is a PDF file loaded there. It was loaded on the 5th at 2:15. Can you see that? But then let's quickly go back because I gave you an example of something similar. Do you see they say it opened on the 1st of January? So some student now will start panicking. Say that student logged in here on the 3rd of January and they already registered, for example. Then if this is not there, they're already panicking, even though the due date is still very far. So just check such things. There is no, some things, even if you panic, you have nothing really to do to change that. So just, this is UNISA. There will be a whole lot of other things that might disturb you. I'm not saying we are bad, but I'm just saying you need to have patience. We have too many students, to be honest. Hence, I'm advising everyone that is attended this session, do your things on time. Do not wait for the last day for anything. So I'm going to quickly open this and show you the questions. It might be similar to what you will get once it's time for you to do your assignment. If you can recall, there was one of the announcements that I've opened where the lecture said assessment one questions are on Moodle. Moodle, they basically mean they're just here on MyUNISA. Don't rest your brain about what is Moodle. And then assignment two for that particular, in fact, for this, for the same subject, they said it's on tutorial letter 101. So this one, it's tutorial letter 102. This is where we see the numbers. Can you see that? Tutorial letter 102. So those that are doing this subject and have chosen for physical material to be given to them, that means they would have already received this letter when they registered with the same package. But then for someone who chose online only, this is the only platform. Or perhaps this could also be loaded in your additional or your official, but it's important that you check as a student. Did I explain that correctly? Did you understand it? Yes, because some lectures, when you open this, it's just, it's not even a tutorial letter. It's just a PDF document with questions only. But if it's like this, then this is a formal document at UNISA, meaning can be posted to you. You can get it on campus in the dispatch if you chose to have physical material. So let's move and check where the questions are. Can you see there isn't a lot of things here? It's just page number one telling, giving you information that you know already about the subject. And when you go to second page, straight to the point, assignment one. And they're telling you how it contributes to the earmark and everything. And those are the questions. So now that we've seen the question to this type of an assignment, the next one is how do we answer such? Remember, this is a PDF document. So for now, don't think you will need to open your computers. You can just watch on the screen because I don't want you moving from where you are. So with this, all you need to do to start your assignment, you're going to need Microsoft Word to type in your answers. Should I repeat that? You have questions. Now you need to give us answers. So we don't have a platform where you're going to put your answers on a computer. So you're going to have to go to your computer. You can just watch what I'm doing on the screen, leave the questions there, and you go open Microsoft Word. And once that is open, you open a blank document, a new document, and you just start typing. And remember the instructions, save it with your student number. So before I work on any document, I start by saving. So once I have my Microsoft Word open, first thing I'm gonna go file, save it as a Word before we even convert it. They said it must be my student number. Yes, well, don't mind that. But then another important thing is to choose the location. Where do you normally save? Do you save on your desktop, my document, memory sticks? As long as you will be able to get it when it's time to submit it. So all of us have different preferences on where to save. So for the sake of mine, I'm gonna save it on the... For this one, I'm going to just choose to save it on the desktop. So that's what you will do as well, but you can choose your different location. So with that, it's saved already. So what I will do, the important thing here is the answers. You don't need to be giving us the questions back. We have students who prefer to go to now type the whole question that we gave them and give it back to us. That is not necessary. To save time, when you get here, you just write question one as well. I'm not going to write in full, but don't be like me, just for the sake of time. So you're just going to go question one, and you give us the answers for question one. The important part here, the naming. If your lecturer chose to use one or A, do the same. But just give answers only. Yes, if you have time, you can even decorate the whole document if you want, but then you're not going to be penalized for not underlining, but you will be penalized for not using the following the instructions that your lecturer has given you. So basically, this is now your assignment. Are we still together? Yes. Basically, I'm just going to assume we finished now all five questions, right? And here is the assignment. We are ready to submit it. We are done. We want to submit it. Remember, I already saved it as a Word. Remember that? Okay. So, but before you submit, I'm sure you are told somewhere, I just didn't see it now, but UNISA wants you to submit PDF document, not Word document. So any document that you're going to work on, including your exams, make sure you convert that to PDF before you upload. Should I repeat that? Do not submit. Anyway, I think it's disabled, that option to submit Microsoft Word document. So you are forced, in fact, to use PDF. So this is now the Word. And for you now to submit it, let's say this is all your assignment, all 5 or 10 questions answered. Now we're going to save it again as a PDF. So now we are basically going to convert this to PDF. You're still going to go to File, the same steps I followed when I started. But because I already saved it in the beginning with my student number as per instruction, now it says save as a copy. Then again, I'm still going to browse to the same desktop. And can you see where it says save as type? Once you click on that, you need to choose PDF. Do you see that?
Yes.
That's how we convert your Word to PDF before you submit. And this you will do for all your written assignments. Also, your exam. Your exam at the end of the semester or at the end of the year will need to be submitted in this format. And if for some reason you're still using the older version of Microsoft Office, which does not give you, all right, I'm going to start it here. These are the questions to this type of assignments that I'm doing an example of. And to answer this type of a question, as you can see, they are asking questions that requires you to type, unlike the other ones where it was just multiple choice on the computer, you just select a right answer there. That one, it's easy, just do it on the same screen inside my UNISA. But for this type, you need to now go and open Microsoft Word. So you need to know how to locate Microsoft Word on your own computers. Like that. So once that is open, you open a new blank document. And there was an instruction from this particular lecture which said, make sure you submit all your assignment with the naming of your student number. So basically they're saying save your assignment as your student number. But please, it's not all the lectures that are going to say that. It's important that if there's any instructions, you follow them. But for this particular one, we are told to use student number. So before I even start answering the questions, I save the file. Just in case I lose it. Not everyone, I think, is using the updated version of Microsoft, which is the recent one, which is Microsoft 365, which you can auto-save everything. You don't need to save, but then it's still not as user-friendly because somehow you need to locate that document. And if you didn't choose where you saved it, then it's there, but you need to find it, and that will need time. So it's easier to just now go to File, as I'm doing, then go to Save As. And once you select Save As, you go now to Browse. Depending where you want to save, you can either save on your My Document or save on the desktop, on your memory stick, whichever platform that you are used to, as long as at the end, when it's time to submit, you know where to locate it. So I will choose to save this one on the desktop. And once I click on the desktop, I will be given an option here on the file name, which is where the lecture said, use your student number. Yes, and I'm going to leave it as a Word. I'm not going to change it to a PDF for now because we still don't have the answers. You only switch to PDF when you've completed answering all the questions and you're now converting the document. So for now, I'm just going to go to Save. And when it opens, the important part here is to not give us really the questions back or tell us your names. And we already have that. Remember, you are inside your MyUNISA. So all that info, you are all this, what is that number? I forgot, there's this number each that each and every assignment has. There's really no need to be giving us anything back. What is important once you get here is to just go to question one. Like that. Then once you are here, you go back to your questions. Let me quickly locate your questions there. Let me just quickly go. Where's question one? There's assignment one, but I feel there's already a mistake here. I don't know if it's just me. Oh, there's question one. I didn't see it. Can you see where question one is? There is no naming. They just said question one. How does the law of conservation, blah, 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 that is the question. So you need to now go and study the chapters you were told. Remember, this particular lecture told you which chapters to study. This is not a rocket science. UNISA is not going to give you questions without giving you study material. But then some students, we know they are clever enough to answer without studying. So please, yes, we have them and they still get zero. All right, so we have question one. Just make sure you write question one and then put the answer. Well, I don't see A or B. Maybe it's because there's only one question there. You can also just do that. Under question one, then all you do is enter and provide the answer type, whatever discuss, whatever that you need to discuss there. And they say it's 4 marks. Can you see I've written one sentence that doesn't make sense? Well, let's say maybe it was making sense. It's very short. Do you think I'll get 4 marks for that? Exactly. So go all out. Write a paragraph if you need to explain whatever answer you are providing so that out of 4, you don't get a 1. Even if I'm right here, but then this will never give me 4 marks. It will give me a 1 or half. So go all out when you are answering your questions so that you get full marks. Each question is going to be allocated some marks. I don't know if you've seen that. Can you see that? Well, maybe in your, yeah, but all the lectures need to give you the marks so that you are aware. So the total for question one is just that 4 marks. Then we have question two, 6 marks, just like that, or 3 marks. So it's important that you note that, but that you know, because even from matric or wherever, we were selecting which questions we know best and go for those that has higher marks so that we pass in case we're running out of time. All right, now we're just going to assume that we answered all these questions. How many questions do we have here? There are too many. Can you see they're still going? Yeah, they are still going until question 23. So let's say you answered all those and now you are ready to submit. We go back to our word. Where is mine? There. And we're just going to assume in this document we have all 23 questions answered. And now we are ready to submit this document. We already saved this as a word. And as we are working on, well, on my computer, automatically it updates itself. But if on yours it doesn't, it's still good at this point to go and save it again. So it depends on which Microsoft Office package you are using. So if yours does not auto-save, you still need to go back here, File, Save as a copy, because he already saved it once. So just say as a copy, and you still browse to the same location, which was desktop. And remember, I said, as long as you remember where you saved the document, it is fine. So we're still going to save it again as a Word for those who maybe perhaps their computers are not auto-saving. Then you just say save. The computer will give you this message. You already saved a file name with the student number. Do you want to replace it with this one? You say yes. Remember, we saved it with just the student number without any answers. So now we have all the answers, so you can replace. Now we have it as a Word. We're going to save it again. Same steps, but this time we're choosing PDF. Same steps, but we're just going to choose a PDF. The reason we're saving the initial document is because PDF is not editable. Say at this point, let me first save this so that I give you that example after. You still save it as a copy, browse. You don't need to change anything else except here. Well, the location perhaps as well. Make sure you are on your desktop or whichever location you selected in the first time. Then save as type, which is here. You're just going to click on PDF. Only need to click on it once, then you go to save. Most of the time when you save a document as a PDF file, especially if you are converting from Word, once you hit on save, it will automatically open that document. Then now you see the one that you need to submit, which is this one. So the reason we are having this document in two formats. Let's say at this point, before you submit, you realize that you missed one question or something else is wrong, or you want to add or remove something. Can you edit this PDF document? No. But then do you have time to go and maybe start again or go to the internet to check out to convert this and that and that? There is no time. But then if you still have the initial Word document, all you need to do is to close this one and go and locate, you can close this one as well, because remember we already saved it. So all you need to do is to go to your desktop now and locate the assignment from there. And if there's anything that you want to change, then you change it from this one. But then if you didn't have the word, like for example, we are panicking when it comes to assignment, especially exams, you might have this one open, and when you save, automatically you make it a PDF. The system will allow that, but should they have anything that you need to, should you have anything that you need to add or edit or fix for whatever reason, then now if you don't have this one, basically you're gonna run out of time to start to locate it and all those things. Does that make sense? Have the original Word document saved before you convert it to PDF. I think I've spoken about this for too long now. So now we go back to MyUNISA. We are done with, we go back here. Remember, that's where we got the questions, right? So even to submit, we're still gonna go back to the same place where we got the questions. Can you see add submission? Yes. That is only gonna be there until the due date. Same as the quiz, once that time and date comes, this will disappear and you cannot submit anymore. So submit anytime before the time, the due date, and that time. The time is also very important. So don't try to submit on your site. Also here, I'm not gonna go all the way. I'm just going to show you the few steps that happens after you opened this, but not all the way, because otherwise we'll submit this and it will be a zero for someone. So once you're ready and you show that all your answers the way you want them, then you click on add submission. Can you see what happens after you click on add submission? Yes. You need to move your mouse. Can you see where the mouse is? You need to go to these two icons. Can you see once your mouse get there, they are writing for you what that is. It's add. So we are here because we want to submit. Exactly. So this is what you're going to use. Add your document in here. Others are able to drag and drop, but I prefer this. You go to add, you click it once, or may quickly go back. Remember, I told you they will tell you the format that they want. Can you see accepted file types? Only PDF there. So meaning if you load a Word document there, it will not go. And if you don't read whatever messages are gonna appear after this, somehow you might think you submitted. But then there will be an error message that is going to be displayed. Perhaps it might say file format, I don't know what it might say, but there will be something that will notify that it did not go through. So now let's go again, add. Once you click on add, you get upload a file. Can you see that? Then you click on upload a file. Then choose a file. Can you see that? Yes, you click on choose a file. Now it's important to know where you saved. Remember I said you can save anywhere, as long as you will know how to locate the file you're submitting. So mine was on the desktop. So currently I'm elsewhere. So I'm just quickly gonna locate my desktop. There it is. Then I look for my assignment. Then once I find it, this one, it says Word. Do you see that? That's not the one we need. The same one, but in a PDF format. Can you see that? Yes. Then you just double click on that. Can you see we now have the file name there? make sure you see it before you proceed. There was nothing there before we uploaded. In here, you can skip this. It's not important. This one here, it will always be your name. This. Once you submit, there will always be your name in here. Remember, I said we already know who you are because you logged in with your details. Hence, you don't need to give us a brief introduction before you give us the answers. Yes, we already know who you are. And this stage, I'm not going to go, but then once you click here, then the file, which is this one, it will be uploaded. And remember, there is also a verification after this, but for the sake of respecting this account, I'm just going to stop on this one. But after submitting, you will click on upload. Then there will also be one last step after this, which is just a verification that you are indeed aware that you are submitting an assignment. Then you upload again. After that, it will take you to this one. Quickly go. This. Remember, I said after submitting, it's important that you come here and check that your document has been received. And in here, if you followed all the steps, you will have a message that your assignment has been submitted successfully. Only then you can move to the next. Are we fine with this part? Yes. And it will also give you the date and time you submitted. I know some students always want to have proof. Then this is where you can take a screenshot with your phone to show that you indeed submitted this assignment. So if there's any questions regarding this, those that are online on the chat, type the questions regarding any assignment submissions. If you missed something, those that are here, you will have also an option to raise some questions at the end of the session, not now. And also note, can you see this? For this particular subject, there's three assignments. Some will have one, two, not one. I've never seen a module that has one, but two is the minimum number of assignments that you'll be given. But then some modules can have up to nine. Yes, no. Up to nine assignments per subject. So you will see all that as you change from one subject to another. Can you see this student has a lot? Can you see also here just after assignment three, there's a whole lot of information. This is an example of a good lecture. Can you see there's even class one chemistry, this and that. So these are things that are not on each and every subject, but if you have anything more that we did not touch on, it's important that you open each and everything. But the general standard, it's up to just after your announcement, and also you will have your assessment, your forums. Any other additional info, it will depend from one lecture to another. Are we still fine? Yes. I know there is some students that has different types of assignments, which will be like discussions, external, tools, amigos, and whatnot. You will be invited to another, but that will be only for those students that are doing those six subjects that I've mentioned. And there is where we will be assisting you guys with such, because they are quite different. We cannot involve everyone in those. We are just waiting for you guys to be grouped. For example, a subject like this one, EUP 1501, if you still have it as just appearing as one like that, there should be two. That means you're still not grouped. That means you don't even have the questions. And there's nothing on your side that you can do except to wait for UNISA to group you, appoint a tutor, and that tutor will open everything for you. Hence, I cannot now talk about SIAD because not everyone is registered for that. It will just confuse everyone. But know that you will be invited if you're doing any of those six subjects. We are going to now move from my modules and go to my admin. But before I move, I wish there was one student in here who is already at least grouped for one subject, except those six, because there will be groups here and there. Is there anyone who has ever heard of groups or who is grouped? Yeah, I guess maybe we organized this way too early, but just know that if you happen to see a subject that is appearing twice and the other a link that is going to appear there, it's ending with a 1E or 1T. Just know you've been grouped, and inside that group, there is someone that UNISA has appointed to help you. They will introduce themselves to you and tell you how you're going to work throughout the semester or throughout the year. But I can see on this one, is there someone who has? Can we quickly just change so that everyone can see, because everyone is going to get that. And it's important that they can see what it looks like. Just give me 2 minutes. I'm quickly going to log out of this account and log into another account so that I can just show you what is a group and how does it work. But just know that once you are grouped for a particular subject, you will be sent an email in my life and also an SMS. All right, I'm back. And this is now a different account. I just want to show you what I was talking about regarding the groups. Yes, this is good. Can you see on the screen here, we have SUS 1501-24 semester one. So that is the main site which everyone gets after they register. Can you see the same subject? It's now appearing on top, but this time it has 39T. That is the group I'm talking about. So for you to be grouped, it will be UNISA's responsibility. As long as you are not grouped for this type of subject, check your announcement. They've already posted that you don't need to worry. Even though the due date might pass, once you are grouped, you will have your own due date. So you might know other students that are doing the very same subject as that one, perhaps your friends, but because they are already grouped, they will need to submit the assignment as per due dates on MyUNISA. But if you are currently not grouped for this type of subject, you just ignore that until you get an SMS that says you are grouped. And your tutor or your teaching assistant is Masabata. Only then you have access. I don't know if there's changes, but from the previous years, what happens is if the assignment is due today and you still don't have a group, there's nothing that you can do on your side as a student, but from the day you are grouped, there was 7 days automatically given to you for the first assignment, not for each and every assignment after that. So, but you will be notified by SMS and emails. And also when you log in, you should be able to see the group there. Does that make sense for those students that will have, you must have read somewhere where they were talking about groups? Yes, just know if you are not grouped, there's nothing that you can do. Just patience, have patience and focus and push on the other subject where you have everything. And this is one of those subjects where if I'm not mistaken, there's like 7 assignments here. So push now while you still don't have access to certain subjects. Can you see assignment up to 7? Yes. So imagine you have 4 other subjects, maybe which each has 3 assignments each. And now there is the 5th subject with 7 assignments. Can you see in total, you're going to have a lot. So push on the ones that you have access so that by the time you are given access on these ones, then you will have more time for it. You will be submitting every week. That one I can assure you of. So push everything now and you will be able to complete everything on time. But then, like I said, I'm not going to talk about this type of assignments for long, because those that are doing that will be invited. And mind you, each and every qualification has this type of an assignment. So if it happens that you, this type of a module, if you happen to have not taken it in the first semester, you will get it in your first semester, in your second semester, and they are all in your first year. But then for others, like this particular student here, can you see we have another one there written EUP, is the same as this one. So, and you registered all those in the same semester. So this also has 8 assignments. So by the time we are grouped, we already seen this has 7 assignments, right? So imagine now when they open this and you have 9 more assignments and we have other 3 subjects, remember. So can you see how I'm saying it's important that you push where you have access now, because by the time you are given access here, you will have a lot on your plate. So try to submit all the other assignments for the other modules so that when you're starting with this, but I'm going to stop it there because, yeah, I'm very passionate about these types. I won't stop. So I'm going to leave it here and ask everyone, no, before that, before we move, can all of you see where we have initials on the top right corner of your accounts? There need to be your profile picture there, not your initials. I know, maybe except from Papa here in front of me, all of you have social media accounts and we have your profile pictures loaded there. And there was no one who invited you to any workshops. You just figured it out. But something so important like this, no one even bothered to go and check. And just a tip, those that are writing multiple choice exams, you're not going to be able to write your exams if you don't have a profile picture there. So make sure, because when it comes to exams, you are invigilated by certain softwares. They need to pick up the picture that you loaded here, compare it to that person that is writing on the day. That's to be the same person. Are we still together? That is very important. Note it down. You're not going to be able to see the questions to your multiple choice, especially if you are using the Moodle, not the Iris, without their profile picture. So to load your profile picture, there is a down arrow there. You just click on it. Can you see profile? Click on profile. Can you see edit profile? You're just going to click on it. And you go down, it's something similar to submitting the assignment. Can you see we have, again, add? Can you see that? Then you just double click on that. If you're accessing MyUNISA on your phone, make sure you take a selfie. Nice selfie. You don't want to see the whole body, just your face, ID size. We need you. If you want to be flagged and not be marked, put your car there. Put your favorite mountain. Put the sea. Those are not allowed. We need your face. And just your face. If you're going to wear a cap and some glasses like that, also make sure when you write your exam, you're wearing a cap and glasses. So basically, just don't look too different. You don't have a beard today, Bab. Yes. 4 months down the line, your beard is like this. Could be your brother. Do you get what I'm saying? Try to look the same as possible as you can. So once you click on your picture there, you're just going to load it the same way. Can you see it's same steps? Choose a picture, then you load it. Then immediately here, you will see your picture. And that is one step to being able to write your exams. We'll have another session where we're going to do an example of an exam paper towards the end of the semester, shortly before you start with your exams. That's where we'll talk more of this. But for now, make sure you upload your profile picture. Please, it's very important. Are we fine? Yes, do that for me. Then that will help a lot when it comes to the end of the semester when we do the practice mock exams. All right, now I'm going to ask everyone to log out of my modules. We're not going to use this, my admin. We're going to log out from here. Can you see just next to your initials? It's important. Let's just listen to this. Remember when we came here, we opened my modules. So open my modules only when you go into your assignment. As much as inside my modules, there's also my admin, but it's not 100% functional like the other one that is outside of my modules, this one. So when you want my modules, you go to my modules. When you want, just quickly wait, you will see what I'm talking about. Yes. Can you see this? Log into my modules for anything that it has to do with my modules. But when you want my admin, which is where we are going now, access it also here, not the one that we just saw inside my modules. Are we still together? Same thing when it comes to my modules. When you go to my log into my admin, there is still a tab in there which says my modules. But also, it's not 100. It might not give you your subject. Something might be missing. So make sure you remember that. My modules for my modules. My admin for my admin. Are we fine? If we're all able to go back here, let's quickly now log into my admin. The difference is you just need your student number and the password, unlike when you went to your My Modules where we needed the whole email address. So when you log into My Admin, we just need your student number and your password without at my life what. Just enter your student number only. All right, I'm in. I'm just going to give everyone a minute or two to log in into my admin, then we'll go through all the functions in there. Are we in? Remember, we moved from my modules to access login to my admin directly on my UNISA, not inside my modules. Is a hint? All right, I'll just give you one more minute. We'll start in a minute. Others are still trying to log in. All right, now that we are all into my admin, can you see what I was talking about? Can you see we still have my module here? Yes, don't use this my modules, always use the other one outside of here. So for now, we're going to focus on my admin because we logged into log into my admin. So you're just gonna click it once. It should look something like that. And we're gonna go step by step on all those functions. So some of these functions that are here, if you know how to use my UNISA and my admin or my modules, you really don't need to be visiting UNISA for anything. You are probably given all the functions that someone needs to help you with if you needed something at UNISA. But provided you use this and you use it effectively as it is meant to be used. So the very first option here, we have student admin. Can we all see student admin on our My Admin? Yes, you just click it once, then it's going to drop down a whole lot of options, with the first option being academic record. So if you are all new here, you have not set for any exams yet, that means this is just blank. It will just, oh, okay. If you're getting something like this, that means there's something wrong with finances. And also note, if you owe UNISA any money, regardless of if it's 1 rand or 2 cents, they block such things, meaning you can't even get your results. So, but can you see your academic record on your side? Yes, since you are new, there will just be the code of your academic. Unfortunately, this one, I'm not going to be able to project because the account I'm using has some issues. But then can you see on yours what happens? So if you open that around June, if you're going to sit for any exams in June, then there will be subjects that you passed or failed. Are we still together? Just give me a sec. Allow me to quickly change the account because I want to show you. Perhaps there's someone who's like me owing, then we need you to see how it's going to look like when you are paid. Yes, you should see something like this. Do you have something like that on your computers? Yes. So once you have something like that, say you have any semester subjects, when you click on here, can you see it's a link? It is changing. Don't click on any other thing except where it's written a code, because that's only where the link is. Can you see that? You don't need to click it. I'm just going to show you. Once you have that, can you see it's blank? So this is a new student who has not sat for any exams at UNISA yet. It should be like that. But then after you've written all your exams in May, June, and you got the results, everything will reflect here. Either pass or fail, supplementary. So basically, this is your study record. And normally, you will need an academic record. Say maybe you're using a bursary. They sometimes want to see your academic record so that they can check if you are passing, or maybe your parents need to see your academic. It's basically, it can be requested by whoever is in charge of your finances. But as UNISA, we don't send this to anyone. If someone needs it, it's going to go to your My Life email, then you send it to whoever. If you are working and they want to see the progress, then you also get it from here. So it's not going to be automatically emailed to you. Can you see email courses that are passed with marks? So there's two different ways or three of you getting this academic record. You can either request for UNISA to mail this to your My Life without the marks, meaning you can just say ENN passed. Another subject failed without indicating the percentage. Then this option or this one is with the marks. This one here, if you click on this, then it will send you your academic record without. Then this one here, it can also be emailed to you with everything. But then there is also this option here. Can you see view? Display all study units. Let's say it's your parents or whatever, whoever is requesting that, and you don't want them to see that some subject you repeated maybe 3 times. In here, you have an option. Can you see display credit only? If you choose that option, that means it's only going to list the subjects that you passed. So if you repeated one subject 3 times, it's not going to be reflecting on that particular academic record. But if you don't change the settings here is going to email everything, even though sometimes say maybe you didn't write, you missed the exam for whatever reason, all those will be listed there. So just make sure you know that you have the function to do your own settings depending on what you need. And please do not waste your time whenever this document is requested, wherever, by coming to UNISA. We no longer print as an institution. Make sure you just log into your MyUNISA and use this function to email it to yourself. Should you find yourself on campus to request this, they will still do the same. They will email it to you. You need to go to an internet cafe or at work or forward it to whoever who can print for you. So basically, no one is going to hand it to you. Are we fine? All right. We're going to move. And also, it is on a letterhead. It is stamp. It is the official document. If you happen to print it in color, perfect. So you don't need to print it and come back to UNISA. They say it's not professional, put a stamp here. No, 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 it's 100% official. Can we move? So don't waste that petrol. Don't waste that time to come to request this on campus, because it's still gonna be sent via MyLife. Another option we have here is to apply for credit. So this option is going to be used by those students who switched from other universities to UNISA. Let's say you went to UJ or VET or wherever to do your first year, and now you are at UNISA to do your second year, but you are still a new student at UNISA, hence you can find yourself in this workshop. So for you to apply for credit to where you come from, this is the option. Don't come to UNISA. You're still going to be referred to your MyUNISA account to do this. So basically, once you open it, you can just watch on the screen. They will ask you, oh, my system is a bit slow. Yes. Once it opens, it's going to look for look like something like that. They just want the institution name, where you're from, and the module code, where you're from, NQF level, the year you passed it, and the equivalent code at UNISA. So you need to know all this information before you even come here. Compare where you come from, it was called ENN something, but here at UNISA we call it something else. So it is your responsibility to make sure you know all that information. So this is where you're going to apply for credits if you need any credits. I'm gonna be offline. My system is acting up. All right. Another option here, we have biographical details. Do you all have biographical details? Click on it. It's very important that all the info you see there, it's correct. Because at the end of your qualification, those are the names that are going to appear on your certificates. And if you have an incorrect cell phone number there, you need to make sure you go to the student admin and fix that. Unfortunately, some of these options are disabled. You cannot, for example, update your contact details. For safety reason, you need to go to the nearest campus for this one and you will be assisted. Also, my life email, you cannot edit that and put your personal email. It is like that and you are stuck with that email until you complete. And should you later want to do your postgraduate with us, you will still use the same email. So we cannot run away from my life. We're going to show you how we use that towards the end of this session. So because we have, they don't want to use my life, they prefer their own. Unfortunately, once you registered, we no longer use any personal email addresses for anything. It's my life all the way. Are we fine? Yes. Should you move from where you're currently staying, there is an option for you to update your address details. Can you see that? Yes. For those that have chosen for UNISA to deliver study material, this is very important. Locations. On contact details, you can change any other except your cell phone. So maybe if you have a landline or any other that is allowed, you can change. You have an option to, but then on your cellular phone, you do not have that. I don't think this one is applicable anymore because we are now online. Previously, we'll have different exam centers listed here. Then you choose the nearest from where you stay in. So can you verify that everything is correct? Address, names, registration, region. This one is very important, guys. Can you see Florida on this particular student? That's because the student is closer to Florida. But if you happen to have chosen perhaps Mafikeng, you will, should we have contact sessions like this one that are not online, then you're not going to be notified by our office. You will be notified by Mafikeng office. But online, whatever engagement that you might have, it goes to everyone. But on the contact ones, you will miss out because the method we are using to invite you is per region. So if you have anything else, make sure you change it. But for those that are online, please leave it as it is, because I'm not sure where you're connecting from. Everyone that is a first year student, I believe, was invited and given that link. So you don't need to change your option to Florida if you connected online. Whatever office you chosen to begin with from your registration, I believe it's still fine. Can I move from this option? That is your biographical details. We have Digital Access Center. This, at the moment, it's not functional. It was meant for those students that are in the rural areas. Let's say you are in, Gauteng doesn't really have much rural. Let's say, for example, you are in Limpopo, and the nearest UNISA is in Polokwane, and you are somewhere else, maybe 10 hours or 5 hours from the office. UNISA used to go into contracts with internet cafes in your area, but that was only in the, mostly in the rural, so that you have access. Basically, you'll go to that internet cafe, you will, we will pay them on your behalf, basically. But the contracts have all ended now. There will be a new way of doing that. But then if you are here physically, that means you are the closest. So if you are closer to the campus, there wouldn't really be much. We used to have one somewhere in Soweto, but the contracts have ended. But then if you are still very far from the UNISA site, you can keep checking on this site to check if that process has not been updated, and you will be given internet cafes that we work with closer to what you stay. But for now, there's nothing. All contracts have expired. They will be extended with time. But for those that are online, everyone here, I believe, this is, you are stuck with us. Another important option there is enroll for learning. This one, can we all click on it? Can we open it? Because if there's any classes, we're going to enroll for those right here, right now. Enroll for teaching what? My computer is a bit slow. And it has logged me out. Johan, I think I'm going to need a cable. Do you have yours? Mine is in the office to connect. Yeah, because I use this one since I don't have a network port. But I'm sure on your computers it has opened, right? Mine, it has kicked me out. I think I'm offline. I'm just quickly going to change from Wi-Fi to the cable connection so that I don't get kicked off several times, because this will drag the whole workshop now. While they're still helping me with that, let me see. If you have any subjects listed there, that is the time for you to enroll for those classes. But then if you have nothing, that means you don't have any classes for those subjects. And if you have any like that, click on enroll one at a time. And on that drop down arrow, can you see that? Click on it. Select any office that is appearing there. Those classes are going to be online. So you don't need to go to Polokwane or anywhere. As long as you enrolled and you selected any office, you click on submit. When that class happens, you will be given a link in your My Life account to connect online via Teams. But if you don't register, if you don't enroll like that, you might not know when there is any class for your subject. I don't know if we are still together. I'm quickly just going to log back in. Keep enrolling for those while I still log in. All right, I'm back. Did you manage to enroll for whatever subject that is appearing on your classes? Yes, as still explaining, if you manage you want, please, you don't need to travel to anywhere. You will be sent a link in your My Life email. You're just going to use that link to connect, just like the guys online. Everyone that is online was given a link to connect. So that's the same way everyone will connect to any classes that they may have. Can you see this is all Polokwane, Polokwane? Doesn't mean the student has to go to Polokwane. But if you were still not an online student, university, only students that were in Polokwane are going to be able to attend a face-to-face class for this particular subject. Can you see now being online sometimes help even though things? Because now it's online, even those that are in Polokwane, it's still online to them. It's just that whoever is presenting is based that site, but you all get to benefit. So you just enroll and you leave it like that and check your My Life emails. Next option, we have final semester requests. This option here, I need you guys to understand it. In your last semester or last year before you complete your qualification, UNISA allows you to exceed the number of subjects that you can do at that time. Because you are completing and you have maybe six subjects. And we know that UNISA says five module, it's a maximum per semester. But if it's your last semester before you graduate, you use this form to request UNISA to open extra two subject or extra one, so that you don't come back the next year or next semester to do just two or one subject. But this information is only here. Hence, I said in the beginning, it's important that you know how to use this. You will find yourself with such dilemmas because you might get a supplementary for certain subject throughout your 4 years with us. You might fail some subjects. That makes you to accumulate more subject at the end of the semester. For example, if you are clever enough, say you are doing LLB 4 years, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, you don't fail anything, then you are fine. But should you now fail one subject, you're going to repeat it in the next semester or sometime next year. Already, you have one additional year if you fail, or additional semester. So what this means, should on your last semester have seven, you can take all that seven, provided you use this form. Otherwise, the system is going to reject you and say maximum is five, meaning you come back next semester for two. Make sure you remember this information. I believe this is the only time you'll get to hear of it. So you will only need this when you are in your last year, if you have more subjects. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
Please remember that. You don't have to come back, especially also for those that are doing higher certificates. If you are doing five now, you probably have another five left. Should you fail one, then you have six in the next semester. Can you see that? And the system will allow you to do only five, but you have extra one. Are you going to come back for that one next year instead of maybe going to your degree? That's where you need such a form. But if you don't use it, you're going to write your five, maybe fail another one. Now you have two and come again next semester in 2025 and you're doing just two subjects. So make sure you remember, especially the high certificate ones, because you're going to need this very soon. I'm not saying you're going to fail. I'm just saying, know that there is an option for you to make sure you pass or go faster, not to pass, but then just to finish in 1 year. But let's make sure we all pass what you registered for so that we don't get here. And there's also another part about your graduations. This is also valid for your last year. You only graduate when you've completed your qualifications, right? Yes, and those that are doing higher certificate, you don't graduate. Are we together? Yes. If you are doing your higher certificate, it's because you don't qualify to do a certain degree. So it is just for you to go to the next qualification. So you're not going to have any graduations for that. But remember, you don't move automatically from higher certificate to your degree. Come next application around September, you still need to apply for whatever degree you want to do. It's not just a smooth sailing to the next qualification. You need to apply. So if you don't apply when you're writing your last subject in your higher certificate, you're going to have a gap year after your higher certificate while you wait to apply 2025 for 2026. So make sure you apply in September for your next qualification. That is for those that are doing higher certificate. I hope that was clear, because I'm not going to. I will remind you if you come to me saying, I can't register, because some, they don't do anything until it's January next year. And they say they come here to register and system says register for what? Because it didn't apply. So no one is going to share this information. It's on your website, on the My UNISA website. It's up to you as a student to read it. Very important. No one is going to remind you. We have, again, readmissions. So readmission, we have students that have been phased out for whatever reason UNISA may have. Do you think if you registered 10 subjects and you pass only one, you are still eligible to continue with that subject? Exactly. If you are using a funding, will they still continue to fund you? Exactly. Even at UNISA, we can still exclude you if you don't perform well. And I'm not sure how they do it this year. I've seen previous years, they will suggest a short course for you, which you're going to go and do for a year. After you successfully pass it, then you come back to the system and use a readmission form and continue with that qualification. So make sure you perform to avoid this. Are we fine? Yes. We have also register additional modules. This option here is what you're going to use in July when you register for second semester. That is if you want to register yourself. Do you see that? Yes. When it's registration time, this opens for you to register. But if you're not sure how to do it, it's quite friendly, to be honest. But if you don't know the subject, you might still need assistance of the student advisors, which are in the student DSAR in the ground floor. But whoever is online, you can also get access through your regional offices. So if you are here, you connected, after you write your exams, you need to re-register for the second semester. That is if you didn't register for the whole year. You can use this option. Already there's your names and everything in there. The subjects that will be appearing there are applicable, but remember we have some electives somewhere. So there will be more subjects than you need to do. You need to check your curriculum and check which subjects are applicable to you for that particular qualification. But like I say, if you're not sure, go to registration department, queue there, and you will be assisted. But you do have the option to do it yourself. Are we fine? Yes. You can request cancellation of modules. Just like now, you registered for 5 subjects, and for some reason you feel like it's too much. You have an option here as a student to cancel. There's an option where if you cancel within certain days, you can get your money back. But in after certain days, you forfeit everything. But I really do not want to dwell much on that. It's not my department. But then just know you can cancel your registration. But then don't cancel a day before your exam and expect UNISA to refund you. It won't work like that. You're still going to forfeit everything. So there is certain due dates for these options, especially to cancel. And also, anyone who has your student number and your password and sometimes your phone, I don't know if you are aware of the new authenticating method that UNISA has introduced. Well, for some of you, since you are new, that's the only way you're going to know. But then previously, just student number and password will get you in here in my modules. But then now I've seen you are asked to verify that it's you via authenticator app or one-time PIN. So if someone has access to your phone, they can actually log in here and cancel your registration and also fill the refund form to get the refund from UNISA. So protect your password and protect your phone. I know as partners, sometimes we share, but if I were to start telling you about stories of partners who fight and some are that spiteful that they will come and do this on your behalf. On our system, it's just going to show you canceled. It's not going to say someone else did it for you. So let's protect our login details. It's very important. No one is going to save you. How are we going to prove that it's not you? Where else is inside your account? Let's make sure we got our password and our phones. Request the proof of registrations. Some of you that are funded by bursaries, before they pay, they want this letter. So even if you come to UNISA, it won't be handed to you, just like your academic record. All you need to do as a student is to click on proof of registration and request a letter. Can you see that? All you do here is just to click here on that button and your letter is emailed. So whoever needs to pay or whoever needs to do anything, this is the official letter that proves that you are a UNISA student. There isn't any other formal document that you'll get that proves except this one. So you only get it here. Even if you come to me or whoever working at UNISA, they'll still log into their system and email it to you. Did you get that? It's very important that we save time by coming to UNISA for things that are here. Another important one, we have request for semester exchange. So this option, guys, let's say you registered for 5 subjects now and you have not registered for second semester yet. And since at UNISA we don't have classes, you find yourself at some point getting a job. You get a job, it's too demanding, and you want to switch, maybe take 2 of the subjects from now to second semester. This is the option, just to take off some of the load to the second semester. But remember, that is adding additional years to your qualification. So if you are going to complete in 4 years, then it might take you 6 years to complete. So, but just know you are able to do that, but also you can do this at any given time. There is due dates for you to do such, but just know there is that option. Are we fine? Can I move to the another tab, which is now the study material? This is valid for those that chose Korea. Yeah. Those that chose Korea, if you click on parcel tracking and scroll down, you will see that there is already a package that was posted, but it's a long time ago. Probably the student already received this. Most of the time you'll find there's even a trace number, but yeah, there will be information for you there, but only for those who chose hard copies. If you chose strictly online, there won't be anything there for you. So that's the only option under study material. And let's quickly go to student finance. I'm not a finance expert, but I'll just touch on this one. You can actually make payments from MyUNISA by choosing credit card payment. You just click on it, then they'll want the card name, CVV number, expiring date, then you're already inside your MyUNISA. So already you don't need to put account numbers and whatnot, I think. Well, let me just say, you will be able to pay using this method, but I'm not in finance. My role is just to alert you that there is a function for you to pay. I'm not really sure what else it needs from you. What I can touch more on is the financial details. Can we click on that one? Yes. Click on that. Can you see your financial statement there? Yes. So check that thoroughly. Can you see if you have not paid for all the registration amount? On the 31st of March, there's an amount there that needs to be paid. Can you see also around May, there is an amount. So just make sure you settle those on time, or just keep on depositing whatever you have, so that at least at the end of the year, you cleared the current fees. It's painful to find yourself with results that are blocked and you're owing 13,000, you managed to raise it to pay, then now you see your result and you passed. And obviously you need to continue and register for the next year or next semester. In the very same month now, you need to raise registration. So it's better to just pay whatever you have when you have it. Just make sure by the end of the semester, you settled that, because your results will be blocked. You're not going to be able to see your results. You will be able to write your exams, but you won't see your results. Please make sure that you check that. Those that are funded by NSFAS, most of the time they'll just pay everything at once, then you sort it, or whichever bursary that is paying for you. Are we fine? Please keep checking that, and you should be able to see your results at the end of the semester. There is also an option here. Let's say for next semester, you want to work out the budget for the next semester subject. Once you click on this, it will just request your qualification code, and you enter your subject code, which you want to do next semester or next year. So to use this, you must know the subject that you're going to do next. Then you'll be given a total amount that will be needed for next semester. So if you are self-paying, then you need to start budgeting. Are we fine? Yes, you have that option. But also, I think where you're registering, there's an option. They can email that to you. They still won't hand it to you. Are we fine? Yes. Can we quickly move to assessment admin? And click on assessment information. You will be prompted to log in again. Just log in with the same details you used to open MyAdmin, which is your student number and your MyUNISA password. Just gonna give you guys an extra minute to make sure everyone is in. Same details, should be easy. All right, I think everyone managed. Once you've successfully managed to put in your details there, this is what you're going to get. This will list all the subjects together with all the assignments that you are required to do. You all have something like that. Can you see that? Yes. So what's going to happen here? Remember, I showed you where you're going to submit your multiple choice assignment, which is a quiz, and where you're going to submit also your written assignment in my modules. But the results are going to be loaded here. Can you see? Let's just go with the very first subject, any subject on yours. Can you see the percentage column on that table? That's where you will get the results of how much you got for that particular assignment after it is marked. Not all assignments will mark immediately. Even those that are marking immediately, there's still some time before they reflect on this system. And on the view, there will be a link for you to actually view the document that the lecture marked. So it will have some comment, actual right, wrong, and whatever the lecture wants to say to you regarding that assignment. Did you guys catch that? You submit assignments in my modules, But to get the feedback, you're going to come on this system and we'll see your percentage here. And you also see your marks. And again, if it's not yet marked on the processed column, there will also be some information there, and return also will get, you will have some information. But what is important is for you to check if it's not yet marked, but then they say it's processed. That means they have not yet marked it. And if you move your mouse to this column where there's a percentage, you'll actually get a message that says your assignment is being processed. Because we have students who will drive all the way just to say, I've submitted, but there is no mark, but there is a message here. If you just move your mouse there, which will tell you that it's been processed. Once it's marked, only then you will get to see your percentage. This goes for both type of assignments that you'll have at UNISA. Everything. If you can just quickly look at my screen, because not everyone has this type of a subject. Do you remember we've done only a quiz and a written assignment? Can you see on this particular student, we have another type which just says external? Yes. So this is done on another site, not my UNISA. It's an external website which student will be enrolled in and given login details on how to access that site. But hence I say there will be another workshop for those students only, because there's a lot to explain when it comes to that. Are you going to be able to get your feedback for your assignments? Yes, please. It's very important that you know where you went wrong and how to fix that before you go to exams. And this will be the only platform for you to get that. So we're going to go back. Where am I now? To now, examination results. May, June, you'll be writing your exams. I went back to assessment admin, just where we got all that information regarding the assignments, feedback, and other things. And now I'm going to open the examination tab. So this tab, you will be using it after you've written your exams. In May, June, some will only write at the end of the year, around October, November, to check the results. Just underneath that, we have also examination timetable. Can we skip a result and just quickly open examination timetable? We'll go back to the results. This is how your timetable will look like the very first time. I believe all of you will have their first exams around May, June. So now just quickly check here on the exam period and choose your next exam period. If there's nothing there, that means you are doing year modules. You need to select October, November. Then after you select it, then you go to display. You will have something that looks like that. And if you check on your status, it says preliminary timetable. So once it's final, around April, that's where there will be dates on when you're going to write. But then for some, you might not have the dates here. Remember the table we were in just now in assessment admin? Some of the dates might be shown there. But like I say, lectures are different. Go to an announcement, open everything, because I have seen students who missed some exams. Because on this timetable, it didn't say when you are writing. But then in your announcement, you are given a date and time. In your assessment table, you are given a date and time. So lectures are going to be operating differently throughout your entire stay at UNISA. Just make sure you check everything. Once you miss an exam, already it's a fail. That means you come back, you re-register, do all assignments again. And for those other type of subject that I've been mentioning throughout, there is no supplementary. It's either a pass or a fail. So if you happen to do one of those subjects, like the one shown on the screen, EUP 1501, you either pass or you fail. So if you get 49, it's still a fail. But on other subjects, if you have a 49, you get a supplementary. So this type of subject, you can actually fail with a distinction. Yes, you can get 80 and still say it's fail. But I'm not going to talk much of that. When your time comes, you will get invited. I will also do it online for everyone so that you know that this subject is structured completely different from the rest. Are we still together? Did you all manage to get your timetable under May, June, or some managed to get it under October, November? But you all got your timetable. That is the whole point, to be able to check it. Now that you know how to check your timetable, obviously you're going to write your exams. And after you've written your exams, this is where you're going to check for your results if you passed or you failed or you got supplementaries. Can you click on now, examination results? And also, you by that time, I think automatically it will be on May, June. Whenever you're writing in October, November, it will also automatically update itself. But if it has not, all you need to do is just change on the exam period. Like for example, if you click on this time period, can you see it says student has no exam for this period? Because that means we are not writing now. There is other students that are writing, hence we have that as an exam period. And another thing that I need to share with you, if you are doing a semester and you get a supplementary, you write your supplementary the next semester. So let's say now you get a supplementary on your English subject. You're not going to write it in a week's time or 2 days' time. You're going to write it at the end of the next semester, just like your other subject that you'll be registering. Does that make sense? In other institutions, if you write an exam today, you fail, you write within 2-3 days, very fast. But at UNISA, you write in the next exam period. Just make sure you remember that. But if you're doing year modules, remember you only get to write your exams at the end of the year. Unlike those that are doing semester, they write in May, June, and also in October, November. So if you are doing year modules and you get a supplementary, then you're going to write it at the beginning of the year. Like I just mentioned, it's actually an exam period right now. So it's for those that are doing postgraduate. So you will get your results in early December, and also your timetable will reflect that you're writing in January and February for your supplementary. So that is for year module students. Make sure you note that, because that means you need to study throughout your December. I hope that one you got. It's very important because some students miss that part, especially if you are owing. You won't see your results by the time you raise the funds to pay and see your result end of January or maybe now, that exam has already passed. Meaning you missed your supplementary, you just need to now re-register it and do it again for the whole year. So let's make sure we pay in advance to avoid such things. We're now going to move to the other tab, which is teaching practice. This one is only applicable to those that are doing teaching. They have some practical subjects which they need to enroll. Once you enrolled for that particular subject, then you'll be told about practicals and how to use this. Basically, you need to get a school somewhere, speak to the principal. If they agree, then you come, get a form from UNISA, take it to a school, something along those lines. But it's not my department. So I just wanted you to know that you will need to use this. If it's not working or if there's something wrong with it, the lecturer for that particular subject is the same person that you need to go and contact. Coming to us won't help you much. So email, call the lecturer, call the department for teaching, then you will be assisted. Are we fine? All right. The last tab that we're going to talk about is password management. Once you click on this option, it opens password, change password. And in here, on the old password, they mean the current password that you used to open this. So should you want to change it at some point, you put the current password here and you choose a new one that you want to use going forward. And once you submit, it will change both passwords for, in fact, not, let me not say both, but it will now affect also my life. So this, we remember we have one password for my UNISA and my life. So once you change it, just know when you go to my life, the password is already changed. Don't use the old one on my life. It always has to be that one. I'm sure you got that one because it's very important. We have students who change the password here, but still go to my life and use the old one that UNISA gave them. Once you use this option, you're updating that password for both accounts. Only use it when you want to change your password. Otherwise, if you don't have the password, you request a new one. That is not changing because you can't change if you don't have it. Are we fine? All right. So now I'm quickly going to go to my life email before we take questions, just so that I show you where's my life, how to access it, and from there we're going to open for questions. For now, you can log out of here so that we are back on the main page. And once you are back on your main page, can you see my life email? Yes. If you want to go to your emails, remember my life is just an email address, just like your Gmail account. You click on it once. Let me quickly log out of my stuff. And once you click on that, it will request you. Let me quickly start it from scratch. It should look like something like this. Yes. Once you click on my life, you must have something like this. And in here, you're now going to put in the whole email address, just like when you went to my modules. On your computers for now, maybe it might automatically log in because we were in my UNISA just now, but just know if it didn't automatically open my life, for you to be able to go to my life, you need to enter their whole email address. Like that. Then you go to next and put the same password you used on my admin and on my UNISA. Then you sign in. You should be able to see your emails. Are we all on the same page? Are we still trying to log in? I'll just give you an extra minute so that you are inside. Are we all in? Can I get thumbs up to those that are online just to show that you managed to switch from your My Unisa or My Admin to your My Life email account? Thumbs up. Do you know how to do your thumbs up? I haven't seen even any. Do we have any? Oh, that's great. I'm not able to see anything on my side. Thank you, guys. And others in front of me, are we all in My Life email? Thank you. All right. Remember, while I was showing you the options on My Admin, there was a time where I requested proof of registrations. I don't know if you remember that. Yes, the very first email in this inbox is the academic record that we requested a few minutes ago. While I was showing you, I was actually requesting that. If you click on the very first, because maybe you didn't request on your side. So this is how your academic record, not academic record, the proof of registration, yes. It's going to look like once you get it. You request it from UNISA. So it is an attachment. So there will be an email with an attachment. And that, but it's important that you read the bottom part. I already know that you need to open this with your ID number. So all the documents that you're going to request from UNISA are going to be password protected. It is not going to be your student number that you're going to use to open those. It's your ID number. And you are actually told, can you see the message there?
Yes.
Yes. They will even show you the last two digits of your ID. If you are using a passport, they will also use the last two digits of your passport. So all the documents will be protected. So you just need to double click on it and put in your ID number. And let me quickly just show you. Yes, once you put your ID number there, and it is the same that is on UNISA system, this is the letter. So this is the only official letter that proves that you are currently a UNISA student for 2024. So each time you register, you're gonna have the same letter emailed to you. But then should you lose it for some reason, you go to My Admin and you request that letter. Remember I told you that it has a stamp. Can you see? It's on a letterhead. There is nothing that you need for you to come, because some will print it and come to UNISA and say this and that. This is the only official recognized letter. No employer, no bazaar, no anyone can reject this. So make sure whenever it's needed, you just get this one and you submit it. It is official. There won't be anything other than this that proves that you are currently registered. We already spoke about that. I was just showing you the example. Again, remember there was a time where I spoke about regions, choosing the office that is clear next to you. I already see one of my colleagues here send an email to students that are registered for this subject. Can you see that? This person is in Gauteng region and is based in Joburg, if I'm not mistaken. So such emails, if your region says Northern Cape, you're not gonna get such emails. And also, if you didn't enroll for that learning, whatever tutorial thing that we're doing, remember that enroll system, you might also not get this. So this is about the classes, and this is an invitation. Can you see that? you'll get something similar to this to attend those classes. And there's even some step for those who didn't register, but perhaps there is another system that UNISA can use to invite you. Can you see register now via my UNISA on my admin student, enroll for tutorial classes. Select Johannesburg. So hence I said this person is in Joburg. But since we are close to each other, hence you are also getting that. Or perhaps, remember this is another student account, is staying closer to Johannesburg than here. Hence they search. So, but just know emails like this are very important. That's how you're going to attend the class. And that's how those that are online got to join us. They got a link like this one. Are we fine? So basically, everything is important that is in here. Make sure you read your emails. And do we know how to write an email? Yes, all of us. Okay, I'll just show you anyway. So once you are inside your MyUNISA and you want to write an email to your lecturer or to whoever, remember this is not just for school. You can actually just use it for anything else. But then for UNISA, this is the only recognized email that we're going to be responding to. Some of your lectures are very strict. If you send them anything with your private email, they might not respond because they want you to actually use this one. Reason being, remember it starts with your student number. So we already know who we're talking to. For example, for this training, if I said book via email and send me emails, some of you will send emails like this. Just check this. We've seen it before because we used this method before. They will be sending me emails like this. That's me. Then in here, they won't even say anything. They'll just say, yeah. So we will get emails like this, but you find it's from your private email. Please book me. How many trainings did we advertise? So many. How will now you know which one you want? So that's why we opted to use that link, because booking via emails, this is what we get in our emails. And we have to now go back to you. Book you for which email? Can I have your names? Can I have your email address? But if you used your My Life, do you know already, I know your student number. I mean, not your student number. With your student number, I can get your contact details. I can check anything to make a follow up. But then to that Gmail, if you just send something like this, most people won't even respond to you at UNISA. So let's just make sure if your My Life is working, only use it for anything at UNISA. Unless if you want to use, you actually fix My Life that is not working and you send me and my colleague an email using your private, because it's our job to make sure this is working, then we will know that we need to attend to this so that you are able to communicate with others. But then to just send your lecture from your private, believe me, some will not respond to you. Let's just stick to using My Life email. And on the subject, always make sure when you're communicating at UNISA, you just put your student number, nothing else. Then on the body, which is where I just wrote, book me, that's when you can explain whatever the problem is or whatever help you need regarding your communication. Are we fine? Yes. Another important factor is this My Life already comes together with a license for Microsoft and the latest software version of Microsoft. So if you bought a new laptop, chances are you are given a trial if you didn't pay some amount, some of the amount, because a cheap laptop, so I don't know how much it goes for now, maybe $5,000? Yeah, something like that. But then if it's like that, believe me, it won't come with Microsoft office a full package. You'll be given a trial for maybe 30 days. UNISA has the, it's not a full license.
The license you get with the UNISA one is for Office 365.
Yeah.
It stays active as long as you're a
student. But you need to update it on yearly basis sometimes. So if you get a new laptop, you can actually just go to the nearest UNISA office and locate computer labs. There should be someone like me, wherever you are, that can assist installing that software for you instead of you going to purchase it. It goes for around 1.6. So you can actually save that and we can load it on your machine. So just remember that, especially those that are using NSFAS, you will be getting new laptops very soon. So just make sure if you are closer to any UNISA regional office, you go to the computer lab for you to be assisted with loading Microsoft Office 365, which is currently the latest version of Microsoft. Did you get that? That is very important because I know some of you will still, even after all this information, go to the internet cafes and those guys will load it for you and you pay them and whatnot. Please remember that, it's very important. I think with that, I can say we are done with the session.
The other website that I've pasted on the screen here, that is where you can check for all the other bookings in the whole of Gauteng and also for Florida then as well. Thank you so much, everybody. Enjoy the day. Bye.